McGraw-Hill Ascent Audio presents Lead Through Anything. Harness purpose, vitality, and agility to thrive in the face of unrelenting change. By Dustin Seale and Ed Manfre. Narrated by Alex Mortensen. Foreword by Dr. Marshall Goldsmith. As lockdown began in March 2020 and the world grappled with the unprecedented challenges brought on by COVID-19, I found myself in a unique position. While many industries were reeling from the impacts of the pandemic, my work as an advisor and coach was in higher demand than ever before. CEOs, leaders, and organizations from all corners of the globe reached out, seeking guidance on navigating the storm and steering their companies away from disaster. During this tumultuous time, Ed Manfre and Dustin Seale were sharing a similar realization. They observed a glaring gap in leadership training when it came to weathering major storms. While many leaders possessed the skills to handle day-to-day fires, they were ill-prepared to tackle the monumental crises that threaten companies and shake economies. Dustin and Ed recognized the pressing need for a comprehensive model that could equip leaders with the tools to address challenges both big and small. In their book, Lead Through Anything, Ed and Dustin have taken on the formidable task of filling this void. Drawing from their extensive experience advising executives worldwide, they provide a refreshing perspective on leadership. They steer away from overwhelming checklists and instead offer a comprehensive model that simplifies the complexities of leadership and culture. Through self-reflection and self-assessment, listeners are encouraged to identify their strengths and areas for growth, empowering them to achieve equilibrium and become thriving leaders. Lead Through Anything takes listeners on a transformative journey, exploring each foundational principle of the thriving state and providing practical methods for fostering a thriving organizational environment. It delves into the three foundational principles of purpose, vitality, and agility. These principles are not only applicable during times of crisis, but are essential for fostering thriving organizations in any circumstances. By embracing these principles, leaders can develop the resilience, adaptability, and foresight necessary to guide their teams and organizations through turbulent waters. What sets Lead Through Anything apart in the realm of leadership development is Dustin and Ed's remarkable depth of experience in the field. Their genuine understanding of the challenges faced by leaders stems from their hands-on work with clients, assisting them in transforming their organizations from the inside out. This book transcends mere theories and case studies as it is rooted in the real-world application of their model, witnessed time and time again. Their insights are not hypothetical, but rather grounded in the realities of leadership in action. In a time where leadership is tested like never before, this book equips leaders with the tools, insights, and strategies needed to navigate complexity, inspire teams, and drive organizational success. I encourage every leader, whether seasoned or aspiring, to embrace the wisdom within these pages and embark on a transformative journey toward more effective and resilient leadership. Dr. Marshall Goldsmith is the Thinkers 50 number one executive coach and New York Times bestselling author of The Earned Life, Triggers, and What Got You Here Won't Get You There. Part 1. The Case for Thriving Leadership in a Disrupted World. Introduction. A Better Way. Roger Enrico and Martin Glenn sat in silence. Roger, then head of PepsiCo Worldwide, and Martin, then CEO of PepsiCo UK and Ireland, were debating the future of one of Martin's most promising lieutenants at a corporate succession retreat. Both were equally unyielding in ongoing conversation about PepsiCo's future leadership. At an impasse, neither knew where to go next. But as key executives in the C-suite, alignment between the two about the company's future direction was critical. Roger was sure he was right about Martin's candidate, but also frustrated he hadn't been able to communicate that successfully. Martin thought he understood Roger's objections, but he didn't buy into them. Adamant that his candidate was the right fit, he would not let the subject drop. Martin broke the silence. "Roger, yes, I get it. He isn't a people person," Martin said. "But everything else checks out." Roger took a breath as he found the point he'd been waiting to make. "Unfortunately, Martin," he said, smiling, "people are the only species we employ." For Roger, intelligence that facilitated results was not enough. Instead, he saw a leader's real gift as taking people along by inspiring them to achieve purpose-driven personal and organizational success. This was one of the company's key leadership drivers. As the architect of Pepsi's successful growth strategies at the end of the 20th century, Roger knew that leaders who elevate their people, teams, and companies can achieve something much bigger than simple short-term objectives. They can learn to lead through anything. Roger's observation carries even more weight now than it did then. In today's world of near-constant disruption, a slew of conflicting demands conspire to crush leaders. Internally, employees require personalized leadership tailored for different generations, cultures, and age groups. Externally, never-ending geopolitical, climate, financial, and health crises conspire to continually raise the stakes. As lifelong students of leadership, we've observed how this chaos affects leaders. While some thrive, many others buckle under the strain. There is, unfortunately, no universal leadership handbook all managers are given when they get promoted. Instead, they're forced to navigate through an unending stream of books, social media posts, and lectures. While well-intended, much of that guidance makes it easy to get lost in the details by creating unnecessary complexity that makes it hard to understand the big picture and the true essence of leadership. This is why we've written this book, to provide the time-tested guidance that we found sorely lacking in even the best-selling leadership titles. As you'll learn as you progress through this book, our training as professional leadership advisors and coaches has inspired us to take a different approach. Our mission involves identifying the most promising ideas within this complex landscape. But we don't just stand outside the battle and advise. We're in the trenches with our clients. What we're sharing has been road-tested, built over 40-plus years, and is constantly evolving with the largest, most complex organizations, as well as some of the smallest and fastest-growing ones in the world. This book represents a collaboration born of our two-decade partnership as leadership advisors, colleagues across multiple firms, and personal friends. Dustin brings more than 30 years of experience advising senior executives, and Ed nearly 20. Our bond straddles two generations, Gen X and Millennial, and two continents, Europe and North America. Between us, we've coached and advised hundreds of executives and C-suite teams across every industry vertical in more than 70 countries. Today, we are partners in the London and Los Angeles offices of one of the world's top leadership advisory firms, which for many years has provided consulting services to more than 70% of Fortune 1000 companies around the world. A leader's journey of growth is inherently personal, so our relationships with our clients stretch far beyond the office, corporate conference rooms, and Zoom sessions. We focus on creating trusted bonds, and in many cases, deep friendships, which we cultivate through shared experiences. We've raced kayaks with the global leadership team on Lake Monsey in Austria, sung karaoke with energy industry executives at Orlando's Disney World, toasted to client successes with financial services leaders atop the Park Hyatt in Tokyo, and played soccer with a global consumer business leadership team in Jeddah, Saudi Arabia. Through the years, we've grown into members of each other's families. If one of us faces a crisis or wants to celebrate a big win, the other gets a text, phone call, or Zoom. We haven't always worked on the same projects together, but our shared belief in the power of leadership has created an unbreakable bond that led to writing this book. We believe the escalating challenges and crises of the modern era make exceptional leadership truly indispensable. Our lifelong commitment is to not only create a world better led today, but also to create a roadmap we can trust to future generations, including our kids. that will enable them to lead through anything and build a better world long into the future. Our objective with this book is to deliver a logical, inspirational, and simplified approach to leadership that cuts through the ever-growing noise that leaders encounter. This approach will help you improve your resilience, effectiveness, and impact. In other words, we want to help you realize your potential to become a thriving individual and leader who shapes thriving organizations. Our strategies are unique in that they are designed to help you continually level up your impact as an individual, manager, and leader. They're adaptable to whatever situation you find yourself in, whether that involves knitting together a diverse team of managers, coaching an underperforming employee, managing boardroom expectations, launching a new strategy, or coaxing a reluctant teenager to mow the lawn. As you'll learn in Chapter 1, thriving is a personal and leadership mentality that balances purpose, vitality, and agility to achieve sustainable success. Individual greatness, stardom, is often reachable with an imbalance and can destabilize or diminish the impact of others around the star leader. In comparison, the well-balanced leaders we are highlighting not only outperform as individuals, but also make the people and organizations around them better. So that you can orient yourself most effectively with this approach, here are some helpful ideas to keep in mind. These principles represent an all-weather model. Come rain or shine. Let's not kid ourselves. We're in a downpour right now. It is often the case that leaders blame external circumstances or challenges outside their control, like the weather, for being a drag on their effectiveness. We specifically shaped this model to remove that variable. These principles are effective in all times and all conditions. When you work on these principles, good things can and do happen anywhere and everywhere. No matter the external circumstances or the size of the team, business, or market, these are the principles we have found you need to focus on to inspire the highest level of performance in yourself and others. Most importantly, these principles empower you to move from being the victim of the metaphorical weather on any given day to becoming the calm center of whatever weather system the day brings you. They are your ongoing navigation system and source of power. We asked ourselves, based on our research and combined 40-plus years of experience with C-suite leaders around the world, what would we tell every leader? The answer is that when you focus on understanding, internalizing, and experimenting with this model, you will be on the right track. As Warren Bennis, the renowned leadership expert, once said about leadership, becoming a leader is synonymous with becoming yourself. It is precisely that simple, and it is also that difficult. These principles are simple, not simplistic. Leadership and culture are complex. Simplicity for its own sake can miss the mark. Our focus is on doing the hard yards that are necessary to get to the simplicity behind the topic. Do not be fooled by the lack of endless 10-point checklists in this book. We have grown dubious of some popular books, trainings, and social media posts that bombard you with 1,000 things, terms, and approaches to hold in your increasingly limited white space. We find these approaches disingenuous in that they pitch themselves as helping you cope while simultaneously loading you with more to-dos. There's not enough time in the day. Rest assured that we have done our best to roll these ideas up to the highest possible level to simplify your to-do list. At the same time, there is plenty of room for growth within each principle, and we have yet to find a particular trending topic with respect to leadership that cannot be contained in one of them. For instance, inclusion and belonging fit superbly within the vitality principle, as you will learn later. Some topics fit across all principles, but the main point here is, if you can name it, we can show you how it fits into this fully comprehensive model. These principles can be, and have been, back-tested for validity. Beyond our research and modern applications with clients, we challenge ourselves to look back through history and apply these principles to standout leadership victories. From sports to politics to business and back again, they are clearly evident in individual, team, and organizational successes, big and small, no matter the industry or context. In fact, that's where many of the stories we share originate. At the same time, you can apply the lack of one or more of these principles to leadership failures across contexts. We will explore later why all three of these dimensions must be present to maximize performance, and how to spot when you are strong in certain areas and deficient in others. Everyone will have a strength and a challenge area. Yes, everyone. The simple truth is that we can't all be great at everything. That includes us and you. Throughout this book, we encourage self-reflection and self-assessment. When we do so honestly, our research has found that the vast majority of us have what we call a front burner principle, which is a clear strength, and a back burner principle, which is a clear area in need of development. That is perfectly normal. There are leaders, and then there are thriving leaders. The leaders we're talking about have all three elements of strength in equilibrium. None of the leaders we write about here or work with emerged from the womb with the perfect triumvirate of thriving. We each, based on personal passions, talents, and circumstances, have developed strong muscles in certain areas and used them to get results that have powered our careers. The model, in full, gives us each something to aspire to as we scale our vision and impact to the next level. It's important to note that even Warren Buffett, now in his 90s, encourages others to take time to invest in themselves and their leadership. As you will learn, thriving gives us an effective roadmap for how to focus that investment. Each principle contains three or more dimensions to develop. Our experience has taught us that it is not useful to think of each principle as a simple on or off switch. There are multiple levels of development within them, so each of us possesses and applies some aspect of the principles in our own way. We have taken the time to categorize three mission-critical dimensions of each principle, supported by stories and evidence, to showcase what brings them to life. The stories include leaders from a variety of industries and backgrounds to illustrate the universal application of each principle. These leaders are from South Africa, Lebanon, Turkey, France, Germany, the United Kingdom, the United States, and more. Some of these leaders we've worked directly with. Others are leaders who have been retained by our firm. The final group is leaders we admire. It all starts with you. What's exciting about this methodology is that it begins with you. You are the only person or factor that you can truly control. As the scope of your leadership grows, whether as an entrepreneur running your own business or the CEO of a large corporation, people increasingly look to you as a role model. We believe in the idea widely known as shadow of the leader, meaning that people you lead are always aware of your presence, your energy, and what you promote, and what you permit. They use these clues to shape their own thinking and behavior. Whatever you focus on tends to become the focus of others around you. Know and appreciate the power you have at your disposal as a leader. If you take the time to start with yourself and focus on developing these principles in your mindset, attitudes, and behaviors, you will create near magical results in a natural and authentic way. These can include aligning people and energy to a common cause, building incredibly effective teams and helping them work together more selflessly, evoking positive emotion more often in yourself and others, increasing engagement and retaining more of your top talent, speaking to the deep human need in your employees, customers, and stakeholders to belong and make a difference, shaping a positive, impact-driven organizational culture, helping everyone to demonstrate healthier values. The state of thriving is an absolutely achievable, positive psychological state of mind, regardless of your profession or management level. When you lead from it, you create a domino effect. Your resulting higher performance and elevated mood or state of mind encourage and support a healthier, more efficient environment. And the improved organizational environment becomes more beneficial to the individual and the team. What's most exciting is that once the three core principles are understood and balanced within yourself, the integration of this state of thriving as a lifestyle takes place naturally and automatically. All that's required from you is the desire to learn and experiment with new ideas and approaches. The journey of this book is split roughly into thirds. The first part explores each foundational principle of the thriving state: purpose, vitality, and agility. The second focuses on measuring yourself and your organization against them, understanding the power of all three together, and learning about methods that foster a thriving state. Finally, we complete the journey by helping you understand how the principles differentiate top leaders, what the thriving teams of today and tomorrow look like, and how to create a thriving leadership legacy. We're excited to share these stories, experiences, and lessons with you because we believe the world needs more and better leaders to master the escalating challenges of this new era. But as Einstein said, we cannot solve our problems with the same thinking we used when we created them. This book describes how we can collectively level up our thinking and our approaches so we can learn to lead through anything. One final note. At the end of each chapter, we offer a set of three questions designed to process and integrate the information you've just heard from insight to action. The first question is designed to prompt reflection. The second, experimentation. And the third, choice. We hope these will help you put the solutions we're offering into practice in your career and your life. Welcome to A Better Way to Lead. Chapter 1. Prototype of a Thriving Leader. Taking his boss's point to heart, over the following decades, Martin Glenn focused on creating people-driven workplaces, right down to the front lines, wherever he led. An eventual four-time CEO after leaving PepsiCo, where he was CEO of Walkers, Martin went on to successfully lead Bird's Eye Igloo, United Biscuits, and the English Football Association, the FA. In our decades working with him through a variety of roles and organizations, we've come to appreciate his qualities as an exceptional strategic and critical thinker, innovator, and friend. During his four-year tenure with the FA, which ended in 2019, Martin introduced a schedule revamp that created a winter break for players and adopted the NFL's Rooney Rule as part of an effort to increase diversity. The Rooney Rule mandates that teams must interview at least one African-American, Asian, Hispanic, or other minority applicant for every future managerial and executive role. Martin was credited with improving association and team corporate culture as well as football and financial performance. Both women's and men's soccer teams reached the World Cup semifinals, while the FA notched a 40% increase in revenue. These gains facilitated record financial investment of more than $125 million in grassroots soccer across England, as well as the establishment of a national soccer training facility to develop future talent. Like other learning-oriented leaders we have coached, Martin unlocked qualities within himself that inspired durable, personal, and organizational success at scale. Regardless of the setting in which he found himself, the recipe for his achievements didn't change. Not many leaders possess the flexibility and vision to achieve success across such diverse businesses as consumer brands and sports governing body leadership. Martin seamlessly navigated the transition by applying people-first principles. Martin is what we call a thriving leader. These leaders demonstrate the ability to create a thriving state in themselves and shape a thriving organizational culture that helps their businesses continually evolve and generate sustainable success. And we mean sustainable in the broadest sense. Far beyond exceeding analysts' earnings per share, EPS, and sales expectations. Even in difficult times, leaders like these somehow defy gravity and, in spite of the odds, find a way to take flight against all opposing forces, all thanks to creating and sustaining a thriving state. Understanding the thriving state. How did the principles of the thriving state come to light? At the beginning of the financial crisis of 2007, the global culture-shaping firm, Sen Delaney, now part of Heidrick & Struggles, turned a spotlight on what separates the highest-performing leaders and organizations during times of great challenge. Initial questions that drove the exploration included, is there a set of common principles that these high performers intuitively share? If so, can the principles be learned and understood by people and teams so that those preferred mindsets and behaviors can be shaped into the organizational norm? Is there a clear approach to sustaining that high-performance culture once established? The answers were uncovered through a collaborative study with three prominent U.S. business schools: University of Michigan Center for Positive Organizations, the University of Southern California Marshall School of Business, and University of California Irvine's Paul Mirage School of Business. The study, conducted in December 2008, surveyed thousands of leaders and managers from more than 60 global organizations across all industries and integrated Sen Delaney research, interviews, and data from their Thriving Index survey. The initial research confirmed three key points, among others. First, there are indeed shared principles at play in the mindsets and behaviors of the highest performers. Second, the leaders who operate from these principles consistently perform at the top 10% of performance ratings. Third, 80% of the time, people deemed to be high thrivers, scoring high across all three principles, automatically model the high-performance cultural behaviors that are found in the healthiest and highest-performing organizations according to the firm's Thriving Index. Simply put, high thrivers shape healthier, higher-performing cultures around them. A lead researcher from USC added, "Our research has shown that people in a thriving state perform much better as rated by their managers and go above and beyond the call of duty. They do things that really benefit other members of the organization and the organization itself. The idea of being in a thriving state, of being your best self, actually is very beneficial to those around you in the organization." Sen Delaney's press release put a finer point on the findings. Leaders who operate from a thriving state and model these principles in the leadership shadow they cast over their organizations can create thriving cultures beneath them. Mastering these three principles will lead individuals, teams, and organizations to healthier, higher levels of performance. In summary, the state of thriving is an achievable, positive psychological state of mind, regardless of a person's profession or management level. The improved organizational environment automatically becomes more beneficial to the individual and team. In symbiotic fashion, the resulting higher performance and elevated mood, or state of mind, encourage and support a healthier, more optimal environment. Shape a thriving culture, and you'll create a self-sustaining, high-performing organization for the long haul. Since this research was first shared with the world, we've made it our mission to positively impact the world by inspiring leaders to shape thriving organizational cultures. Where we begin that journey with any leader is with an explanation of the three principles. Let's dive into them now, and we'll continue to share findings from the research along the way. The study identified the three common principles that underlie this thriving mindset in individual leaders: purpose, direction, clarity, and personal and professional alignment. Leaders with purpose create and share a vision that motivates collective achievements and aspirations. Vitality, a sense of connection and being absorbed in the moment, feeling energized. Leaders with vitality generate a high level of trust within their teams and organizations. Agility, curiosity, creativity, innovation, and constant searching for knowledge and growth. Leaders with agility inspire themselves and others to learn and improve. We captured the integrated nature of these principles in a Venn diagram. The overlap of all three is what we refer to as the sweet spot, where all cylinders of the engine are firing together. These principles provide, in a simple diagram, a roadmap for this book and your leadership journey. Because thriving leaders are rare and special, it wasn't easy to decide which leader would lead off this book. Ultimately, we didn't have to look far to find her: Queen Elizabeth II, who died in September 2022 at age 96, represents thriving at its highest state. Certainly, she wasn't perfect, but the way in which she led the monarchy and the United Kingdom through seven tumultuous decades of disruption demonstrates that she grew in her role over time to comfortably occupy the intersection of purpose, vitality, and agility in an unprecedented manner. During this period of time, the queen led, changed, and evolved herself and the monarchy. The only way this can be accomplished is with a sense of purpose and service, a sense of connection, and a willingness to change and adapt. These are the principles that guided her over the 70 years of adaptation to an ever-changing external environment. We've chosen one incident from her long reign to capture her unique take on thriving. When Queen Elizabeth II visited the Republic of Ireland in 2011, she was the first British monarch to visit Ireland since Irish independence in 1921. Decades of conflict strained the relationship between Britain and its former colony to the breaking point despite an official peace treaty signed in 1998. While the fighting was officially over, the wounds were far from healed when Elizabeth undertook her historic visit. Wearing green in honor of Ireland's reputation as the Emerald Isle, the Queen began her address to the country's politicians and leading citizens at Dublin Castle in Gaelic, the Irish national language. The crowd gasped in surprise as a spontaneous round of applause broke out. This moment was all the more remarkable because it occurred in Dublin Castle, the former headquarters of British rule in Ireland, in the Irish language, which the British had banned in an effort to suppress Irish nationalism. During this speech, Elizabeth II said, "To all those who have suffered as a consequence of our troubled past, I extend my sincere thoughts and deepest sympathy. With the benefit of historical hindsight, we can all see things which we would wish had been done differently or not at all." Her speech spoke to the bond between the two countries, the ties between our people, the shared values, and the economic, business, and cultural links that make us so much more than just neighbors, that make us firm friends and equal partners. But she didn't stop there. The Queen laid a wreath while bowing her head in the Garden of Remembrance in Dublin, a park dedicated to the Irish who fought against British rule. She visited the Croke Park Football Stadium, a site where British-administered police in 1920 killed 14 civilians during a soccer match in reprisal for Irish Republican murders the prior evening. The New York Times described the visit as a trip that ranked among the most politically frighted of her almost 60 years on the throne. While the Queen has no formal political power, her visit, the first by a British monarch, offered powerful symbols of reconciliation and drew broad acclaim among Irish politicians. Her status, both as the head of state and as the most respected member of Britain's royal family, was taken by her hosts as imparting a particular gravity to her words, sealing a closeness that has grown in recent years. That Elizabeth, the symbol of the British state that inflicted so much pain on the Irish, could
help. We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.